Welcome to this video about the Flight One Student Simulator for the Garmin G1000 Integrated Flight Deck. The G1000 Simulator is available as an add-on for the flight simulators FSX and P3D. It runs as a separate application that connects to the flight simulator. This makes the G1000 Simulator highly scalable. You can easily configure a setup with dual monitors or dual PCs. If money is no issue, you can even connect panels with knobs and buttons that look and feel like the real thing. However, a simple setup like mine here, with just one monitor and PC, is possible as well. To fire everything up, start the flight simulator and the G1000 simulator. This brings up the simulator interface window. The interface window hopefully shows your running flight simulator. Select it and press connect. Now the G1000 simulator is connected to your flight simulator. The interface window offers several options to configure the G1000 simulator. Besides the PFD, MFD and audio panel, the G1000 simulator also provides a switches panel and a standby instruments panel. Select which panels to show and position them as desired. All panels run in their own windows. Make sure to check Save Window Positions. Then minimize the interface window. To close the Power Up Agreement on the MFD, press Enter. The G1000 simulator comes with its own set of aircraft, which have no cockpits or outside models. This may seem weird at first, but enables you to use a simple setup with just one PC without degrading the performance too much. You don't need the flight simulator cockpit anyways, because the G1000 simulator displays all panels in its own windows. In a dual monitor setup, use one monitor for the flight simulator window, which gives you an unobstructed view out of the cockpit, and the other monitor for the panels of the G1000 simulator. Next, we would like to enter a flight plan for an example flight from Salzburg to Vienna into the G1000. First, let's enter the departure and destination airports. Press the flight plan key to display the active flight plan page. The G1000 detected that we are parking at Salzburg and already pre-filled the departure airport. We are happy with that and will now enter our destination airport. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to scroll the cursor to the desired insert position. Turn the small FMS knob to the right to display the waypoint information window. And turn it further to the right to enter the first letter. Then turn the large FMS knob to the right to advance the cursor to the next letter. Turn the small FMS knob again to enter the second letter. We could now repeat these steps to enter our destination airport Lima Oscar Whiskey Whiskey, or we can just use the keyboard. Then press Enter to add the destination airport to the flight plan. And press FMS to deactivate the cursor. Now our flight plan contains one large leg going from the departure to the destination airport. If you ever get lost somewhere in the menu and don't know how to get back, simply press and hold clear for 2 seconds to go back to the navigation map page. From Salzburg we will take the Nemal to Bravo departure. So we will fly first runway heading to the first waypoint, which is a flyover waypoint, so we have to overfly it before we are allowed to start the turn. Then to the second waypoint, minimum altitude at the second waypoint is 2800 feet. Third waypoint, fourth waypoint, and then to Nemal, minimum altitude Nemal is 8000 feet. Next, we will load the Nemal to Bravo departure into our flight plan. Press PROC to display the procedures window. Turn the large FMS knob to highlight select departure and press enter. Turn the large FMS knob again to highlight Nemal to Bravo and press enter. Press enter to confirm all runways. Press enter to confirm the Nemal transition. Notice now that load is flashing. Finally, press enter to load the departure. Now the flight plan contains the Nemal to Bravo departure. To review our departure, you can press flight plan to display the flight plan window. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor and turn the large FMS knob to scroll the cursor through the flight plan. Notice that the altitude constraint as Nemal is displayed as a cross at instead of a cross at or above altitude, and that the altitude constraint at Whiskey Sierra 634 is missing altogether. The data in the database is okay, I checked it, so the trainer seems to have a little problem here. The trainer came with a relatively recent Navigraph navigation database. To keep the database current, you would need a Navigraph subscription. To hide the flight plan, press flight plan again. Now let's look at our further routing to Vienna. This is the standard arrival chart of Vienna. Our departure from Salzburg brought us to Nemal, and from there we could already select the Nemal 1 Whiskey arrival to Ballard. But then we couldn't show how to enter in route waypoints. Therefore, we will select the Gamli 5 Whiskey arrival, which begins at Gamli, and use the waypoints Nimdu and Limra as en route waypoints. Minimum altitude here is 9000 feet, so we will use an en route altitude of flight level 110. Next, let's insert our en route waypoints. This is very similar to entering the destination airport. Press flight plan to display the active flight plan page. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to scroll the cursor to the desired insert position. And turn the small FMS knob to the right to display the waypoint information window. Now we could use the FMS knobs to enter the waypoint or, much more comfortable, use the keyboard. So type Nimdu and press enter to add the waypoint to the flight plan. Then repeat these steps to enter the waypoint Limra. Now the flight plan contains both en route waypoints. Press the FMS knob to deactivate the cursor. Next, let's load the Gamli 5 Whiskey arrival into our flight plan. This is very similar to entering a departure procedure. Press PROC to display the procedures window. Turn the large FMS knob to select Select Arrival and press Enter. Turn the large FMS knob to select the Gamli 5 Whiskey Arrival and press Enter. Press Enter to confirm all transitions. Press Enter to confirm all runways. Notice that load is highlighted and finally press Enter to load the arrival. Now for some reason the active flight plan page disappeared, so press flight plan to show it again and check that the flight plan contains the arrival. Our arrival ends at Ballard and from there we expect the Ballard for Mike transition. for an ILS runway 29 approach into Vienna. We won't load the approach right now, but later during the flight. Now our flight plan is complete for now. The active flight plan is erased when the G1000 is powered off or when another flight plan is activated. But we can save the active flight plan in the flight plan store for future use. Let's do this. Press menu to display a context-sensitive menu for the active flight plan page. Use the large FMS knob to highlight store flight plan and press enter. Now the active flight plan is stored in the flight plan store. We have already seen how to insert a waypoint into the active flight plan. Now let's see how to delete the waypoint. Let's say we want to delete the NIMDU. To delete the waypoint, press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to highlight the waypoint to be deleted. And press the clear key. Now a confirmation window should have been displayed, but the trainer deleted the waypoint immediately. Finally, press the FMS knob to deactivate the cursor. You can also delete the whole procedure from the flight plan. To do this, press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to highlight the white header of the procedure to be deleted. Let's say we want to delete the arrival. And press the clear key. You can even delete the whole active flight plan. To do this, press the menu key. Turn the large FMS knob to highlight delete flight plan. And press the enter key. Next, we would like to reload our saved flight plan from the flight plan store. To do this, from the active flight plan page, turn the small FMS knob to display the flight plan catalog page. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to highlight the desired flight plan. And press enter. In this section, we will adjust the G1000 for the departure. First, let's take a look at the common nav radios of the G1000. The G1000 has two comm radios and two nav radios. The frequency boxes and frequency controls for the comm radios are on the right side of the display units. The frequency boxes and frequency controls for the nav radios are on the left side of the display units. The active frequencies are displayed at the inside of the frequency boxes, and the standby frequencies are displayed at the outside of the frequency boxes. Now let's tune COM1 to Salzburg delivery, which is 1 to 1.75 MHz. First, verify that the blue frequency tuning box is placed on the COM1 standby frequency. Pressing the COM knob toggles the tuning box between COM1 and COM2. Then dial in the frequency. Use the large knob for tuning the megahertz. And use the small knob for tuning the kilohertz. And finally press the frequency transfer key to toggle standby and active frequency. Now COM1 is tuned to 1 to 1.75. Another cool feature is auto-tuning that enables you to tune a frequency directly from an information window. Let's use autotuning to set the COM1 standby frequency to Salzburg Tower. First verify that the blue frequency tuning box is placed on the COM1 standby frequency. Then press flight plan to display the active flight plan page. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. The cursor is already at Salzburg, and press enter to display the waypoint information window. Now notice that the waypoint information window displays all frequencies of Salzburg and tower is 118.1. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor and use the large FMS knob to scroll the cursor down to the tower frequency. Then simply press enter to load the frequency into the blue frequency tuning box. Now 118.1 is our COM1 standby frequency. Next we will set the COM2 frequency to the emergency frequency of 121.5 for monitoring. This can be done very easily via quick tuning by pressing the frequency transfer key for more than 2 seconds. So toggle the frequency tuning box to COM2 and press and hold the frequency transfer key. Now COM2 is tuned to 121.5. Next let's take a real quick look at the audio panel. Pressing COM1 mic or COM2 mic selects which radio is selected for transmitting. Notice that the frequency of the selected radio is displayed in green. And the other radio can be monitored as well by pressing its COM button. So that's all pretty straightforward, and we will skip all further COM radio ops in the remainder of this video. Next, let's select our navigation source. The selected navigation source is shown on the HSI and is the one that is used for automatic navigation. More on that later on. The selected navigation source can be either NAV1, NAV2 or GPS. Pressing the CDI soft key cycles through the navigation sources from GPS to NAV1, NAV2 and back to GPS. Notice that the frequency of the selected NAV radio is displayed in green. We select GPS, which we will need later on to follow the flight plan automatically. The map range can be changed by turning the joystick. And we select a map range of 5 miles for our departure. Map panning as well as highlighting and selecting items on the map with the joystick is not supported by the trainer. Next we will set the selected altitude to the initial altitude of the NEMALTO Bravo departure, which is 6000 feet. The selected altitude is shown in the box above the altimeter tape. Currently we have no selected altitude. Turning the large Alt knob changes the thousands, and turning the small Alt knob changes the hundreds. So we set 6000 feet. And now the selected altitude is 6000 feet. Next we will set the selected heading to our runway heading of 154 degrees. The selected heading is shown by the blue bug on the HSI and in a box at the upper left corner of the HSI. Pushing the heading knob selects the current heading, and turning the heading knob changes the selected heading. So we turn it to 154 degrees. Oops. And now the selected heading is 154 degrees. Notice that the selected course is aligned automatically to the desired track to the next waypoint while we are in GPS mode, and we can't even change it unless we are in OBS mode. So changing is not possible here. Next we adjust the altimeter and set the current QNH of 1019er by turning the large combined course bar on. Next we will set our transponder code of 4711. Press the transponder soft key and the code soft key to go to the code sublevel and enter the code 4711. This leaves the sublevel automatically. Notice that the transponder is currently in ground mode, GND. Altitude mode will be selected automatically once the G1000 detects that we are airborne. Next, let's talk about the flight director. The flight director is the brain of the automated flight control system and commands pitch and bank angles. Press FD to activate the flight director. The flight director is always in a certain pitch mode and in a certain roll mode. Each mode enables you to specify a certain flight path, like a climb or a turn, which the flight director translates into commanded pitch and bank angles. After the flight director is activated, he is in the very simple default modes pitch hold and roll hold. Pitch hold simply holds the current pitch angle upon activation and is indicated by the green pit annunciation. Roll hold simply holds the current bank angle upon activation and is indicated by the green roll annunciation. Later on, we will select several more sophisticated modes to manage our flight. If the autopilot is engaged, the autopilot executes the commands of the flight director automatically. However, in the Cessna, we must not engage the autopilot below 800 feet AGL, which happens to be 2200 feet MSL in Salzburg. So we have to hand fly to that altitude. But we can use guidance provided by the flight director during hand flying. The magenta command bars visualize the commands of the flight director. To follow the commands of the flight director, just align the yellow aircraft symbol with the magenta command bars. We will see all that in motion later in the flight. It is important to understand that the flight director and the autopilot are two different things. The flight director issues commands and the autopilot, if engaged, executes them. If the autopilot is disengaged and we follow the commands of the flight director, then we play the role of the autopilot. For takeoff, we will select takeoff mode. Takeoff mode is selected by pressing the go around button. There is no go around button on the trainer panel, but you can assign it to a keyboard key. I assigned the go around button to Ctrl G, so I press Ctrl G now. Takeoff mode commands 10 degrees pitch up and wings level and is integrated by the green TO annunciation both as pitch and roll mode. Be advised that you will get no guidance to correct any displacement by a crosswind. We skip all other checklist items that are not G1000 specific. So now we are ready for departure. I advance the aircraft to the departure runway, so that we can take off immediately. Notice that the active flight plan lag is always shown in magenta. Now set full power. Speed is alive. 30, 40, 50, 55 and rotate. Pitch up to 10 degrees. And now we are flying runway heading to the first waypoint. Now let's pause for a second. Our selected pitch mode is still takeoff, which commands 10 degrees pitch up forever. This will guide us in a straight line up to heaven. And although we want to get to heaven, we don't want to go right now. So we need to select a different pitch mode. How about a pitch mode that provides us guidance to climb with best rate of climb speed to our selected altitude? That's exactly what flight level change mode can do. Just be advised that the trainer always seems to select 80 knots instead of the current airspeed upon mode activation. So after mode activation, we will change the selected airspeed to our best rate of climb speed of 74 knots by pressing nose up. Let's continue. Press FLC to select flight level change mode. Flight level change mode is indicated by the green FLC annunciation and the selected airspeed of 80 knots. Reduce the selected airspeed to 74 knots by pressing nose up. Now the flight director provides pitch guidance to climb with 74 knots to our selected altitude of 6,000 feet. Let's pause for another second. Our selected roll mode is still takeoff, which commands wings level forever. So if we ever want to get to Vienna, we better select a different roll mode. How about a roll mode that provides us guidance to follow our flight plan? That's exactly what navigation mode can do. Depending on the selected navigation source, which is displayed on the HSI, navigation mode gives you GPS, VOR or localizer navigation. Remember that we have already selected the navigation source GPS to get GPS navigation. Now let's continue. Press NAV to select navigation mode. GPS navigation mode is indicated by the green GPS annunciation. Now the flight director provides us roll guidance to follow our flight plan. Now we are overflying the waypoint and the flight director commands the turn. Remember that the first waypoint is a flyover waypoint. So we had to overfly the waypoint before turning. To follow the flight director's commands, just align the yellow aircraft symbol with the magenta command bars. Notice that the second flight plan leg became active now and is shown in magenta. Now we are well above 800 feet AGL and can engage the autopilot. Press AP to engage the autopilot. Autopilot engagement is indicated by the green AP annunciation. Now the autopilot flies the aircraft and follows the flight plan by executing the commands of the flight director. Life is good now. Our selected altitude currently is 6,000 feet. The flight director will automatically command a level off at the selected altitude. Why? Because flight level change mode automatically armed selected altitude capture mode. Armed means that the mode is not yet activated, but will be activated automatically upon reaching the selected altitude. This is indicated by the white Alt-S annunciation. Armed mode are annunciated in white, whereas active modes are annunciated in green. Now let's increase the map range to 10 miles by turning the range knob. Here, the light blue selected altitude intercept arc shows us the estimated location where we will reach the selected altitude. Now let's assume that we are cleared to our cruise altitude of flight level 110. So change the selected altitude to 1,000 feet by turning the large Alt knob. To get the selected altitude intercept arc into view, increase the map range to 30 miles. Notice that the intercept location is not shown along the flight plan route, but along the current track. Everything looks good now, and we are thinking about our first coffee. But suddenly ATC instructors. Stop climb immediately and turn left heading 270. How would we do that? First, let's stop the climb. Press the Alt key to select altitude hold mode. Altitude hold mode holds the current altitude. It is indicated by the green Alt annunciation and the held altitude reference. Next, let's turn to heading 270. First, select heading 270 by turning the heading knob. Then press the heading key to select heading select mode. Heading select mode turns the aircraft to the selected heading. It's indicated by the green heading annunciation. Now we are flying as instructed by ATC. And don't forget to reduce power to keep RPM in range. Next, assume that ATC instructs us to turn direct waypoint Whiskey Sierra 626 to resume our departure and to climb to flight level 110. To initiate the turn immediately without losing time in the flight plan page, simply select the desired heading by turning the heading knob. Then press FLC to select flight level change mode and press nose up to select 74 knots. Notice that our selected altitude is still 1,000 feet. Now we are heading direct Whiskey Sierra 626. Next, we will activate GPS navigation mode to fly direct to Whiskey Sierra 626. Press FPL to bring up the flight plan page. Press the FMS knob to activate the cursor. Turn the large FMS knob to scroll the cursor down to Whiskey Sierra 626. Press Direct 2. The Direct 2 window comes up and Whiskey Sierra 626 is already preselected. Press Enter to confirm the preselected waypoint. And press Enter again to activate the Direct 2. Now the map displays a magenta line from our present position to Whiskey Sierra 626. Notice that we are not following the magenta line yet, because we are still in heading select mode. So press nav to select navigation mode. Now GPS navigation mode is indicated by the green GPS annunciation and steers us direct to Whiskey Sierra 626. Notice the waypoint alert that appears 10 seconds before the turn. And now the flight director turns the aircraft direct to the next waypoint. Next, let's assume that ATC instructs us to climb with 1000 feet per minute or more. Can we do that? No. We are currently climbing with best rate of climb speed and about 500 feet per minute. So 1000 feet per minute is totally impossible, and unable would be the correct word of choice. But let's say we miss that fact and try to comply. In this case, we would probably select vertical speed mode. In vertical speed mode, the flight director acquires and maintains a selected vertical speed. So press VS to select vertical speed mode. Vertical speed mode is indicated by the green VS annunciation and the selected vertical speed, currently 600 feet per minute. Increase the selected vertical speed to 1000 feet per minute by pressing nose up. And let's see what happens. The flight director pitches up, and at first the climb rate increases. But the climb is not sustainable, it costs us kinetic energy, and our speed is decreasing. Now the flight director pitches up even more, and our speed is decreasing even more, decreasing dangerously. And now the stall warning is coming on. If the autopilot ever brings you to an unusual attitude, the first thing you do is to disengage the autopilot. So press the autopilot disconnect switch on the yoke. The green autopilot annunciation went out and the autopilot is now disconnected. Simultaneously fly the aircraft to a safe attitude and airspeed. Also deactivate the flight director to remove the misleading command path. Now we are back at a safe attitude and airspeed. Next, let's re-engage the autopilot. Press AP to re-engage the autopilot. Autopilot engagement is engaged, is indicated by the green AP annunciation. Engaging the autopilot also automatically activated the flight director. As we have mentioned earlier, the flight director initially is activated in the modes pitch hold and roll hold, indicated by pit and roll. This means the autopilot holds the current pitch and bank angles. And don't forget to bring the RPM back in range. Next, we would like to hold the current altitude and fly a heading of 360 degrees so that we can take a look at how the CDI works in GPS mode. To hold the current altitude, press the Alt key to select altitude hold mode. Notice the green Alt annunciation and the held altitude reference. To fly a heading of 360 degrees, turn the heading knob to select 360 degrees. And press the heading key to select heading select mode. Now the aircraft turns to 360 degrees. Notice the green heading annunciation and 360 degrees in the selected heading box. Next, let's take a look at how this CDI works in GPS navigation mode. In GPS navigation mode, the selected course is always automatically aligned with the active flight plan leg. The selected course is displayed in the selected course box and visualized by the course pointer on the HSI. Currently, the selected course is 090 degrees. And the course pointer visualizes that the active flight plan leg goes from left to right. On the moving map, I use heading up orientation so that the orientation of the active flight plan leg visually matches the orientation of the course pointer, as well as the orientation in the real world. In GPS mode, the deviation bar of the CDI visualizes the lateral distance from the active flight plan leg. Notice that this is different from VOR or localizer navigation mode, where the deviation bar visualizes the deviation from the selected radial in degrees. To interpret the deviation bar, keep in mind that the deviation bar kind of represents the active flight plan leg. So currently, the CDI bar visualizes that the selected flight plan leg is behind us. In GPS navigation mode, the scaling for full-scale deflection of the deviation bar depends on the phase of flight. It varies from 2 nautical miles during the en route phase down to 350 feet during the end of the approach phase. The current phase of flight is annunciated on the HSI. Currently we are in the departure phase, annunciated by departure. So a full-scale deflection corresponds to a lateral distance of 0.3 nautical miles. If the deviation like now exceeds the scale, then it is displayed as cross-track error XDK below the aircraft symbol. Currently the active flight plan is 9.2 miles behind us. In GPS mode, the selected course is always automatically aligned to the active flight plan leg and can't be changed unless we select OBS mode. So turning the course knob has no effect. Now press the OBS soft key to select OBS mode. OBS mode suspends the active flight plan and allows you to modify the course to the active two-way point. Notice that the flight plan is no longer visible on the map and a course line is drawn through the active waypoint. Unfortunately, its name is gone. Initially, this course line should be aligned to the active flight plan leg, but the trainer aligned it to our current position. Now you can change the selected course to the active two-way point by turning the course knob. Select a course of 170 degrees by turning the course knob. Notice that the CDI indicates that the selected course is to our left now and goes in the opposite direction. Next, let's try to intercept the selected course. Turn the heading knob to select an intercept heading. Notice that the extract error is counting down. Maximum deflection of the deviation bar is 0.3 miles in departure phase of flight. So at 0.3 miles the deviation bar should become active. And now the deviation bar became active. And we can intercept the selected course. Now we intercepted the selected course of 170 degrees direct Nepal. To deselect OBS mode, press the OBS soft key again. Notice that the flight plan is displayed again, but it retained the modified course line to the active two-way point. If we wish to revert to the original flight plan leg, we can do so by activating that leg. To activate the leg, press the FMS knob to activate the cursor and turn the large FMS knob to highlight the destination waypoint of the leg, which is Nemal. Then press the Act Leg soft key.
Vertical track.
Now a confirmation window should have been shown, but the trainer activated the leg immediately. Next, let's resume our departure. To resume our climb to flight level 110, set climb power and press FLC to select flight level change mode. Then press nose up to select the best rate of climb speed of 74 knots. Next, we would like the autopilot to follow our flight plan automatically again. So press nav to select GPS navigation mode. Because we are currently too far away from the active flight plan leg, GPS navigation mode became armed but not active yet. This is indicated by the white GPS annunciation. GPS navigation mode will be activated automatically once we come within one dot deviation to the active flight plan leg. So we use the currently active heading select mode to steer the aircraft to the active flight plan leg. I skipped a little forward and now our cross-track error is below 1 nautical mile. Now the cross-track error is below 0.3 nautical miles, the CDI bar became active and GPS navigation mode became active automatically, which is indicated by the green GPS annunciation. And now the autopilot intercepts the active flight plan leg. Now we passed Neymar and the next flight plan leg became active automatically. I skipped ahead a little and now we are passing the transition altitude of 10,000 feet. So it's time to select the standard barometric pressure. Press the PFD soft key and then the standard baro soft key. Now standard baro is displayed in the barometric setting box and the barometric pressure is set to 1013 hectopascal. As we have mentioned earlier, selected attitude capture mode armed when we started our climb in flight level change mode. This is indicated by the white Alt-S annunciation. Selected attitude capture mode will activate automatically once we near the selected attitude, which will be quite soon. Now selected altitude capture mode activated and the autopilot begins to level off. This armed altitude hold mode indicated by the white Alt annunciation. And now Alt altitude hold mode activated and the autopilot holds the selected altitude. This is indicated by the green Alt annunciation and the held altitude reference. This brings us to the end of the first part of this video. In the second part we will cover the remainder of this flight, including the approach into Vienna. Until then, have fun and take care. Thanks for watching.